the industry in Asia is still evolving. There are, as you say, very few very large domestic hedge funds. The numbers of hedge funds are huge. I mean, say we have 300 hedge funds in Singapore alone, but virtually all of them have a very small amount of money under management. And I think that's for a couple of reasons. Some people don't want a lot of money. Some people are very happy just to, you know, have a very small number of investors and to operate, you know, in a small niche where it's not scalable. But the other thing, as I said before, is that the cost of running a hedge fund here is significantly lower than it is in other places. So the critical mass you need in order to stay to survive here, you know, is a lot lower. You know, from our own experience, we were cash flow positive as soon as we had $20 million under management, which, you know, these days would not be considered to be a viable amount of money to survive in Mayfair or Manhattan. And so, you know, one of the reasons why we have so many small hedge funds is that, you know, there's the survivability is valid at a lot lower level. Hedge fund investment by Asia, by Asian investors, is still really in its infancy. About 15% of our capital base is Asian domiciled now, but that still leaves 85% coming from outside of our domestic region.
Is that growing? Is there a trend?
Yeah, it definitely is growing. And it definitely is an area that Asian investors are becoming more comfortable with and are increasingly looking at it as an asset class. But it's happening quite slowly.
So who are the latecomers to the party? Is there a certain segment of the Asian investor base that's increasing or starting to go into hedge funds for the first time? And who are these people?
The first investors we saw, and that's not to say that there weren't significant other people in other areas, but the first investors we saw were both the Japanese, particularly the skilled financial professionals. So the very large mutual funds, insurance companies, and banks themselves with proprietary capital. And then some sovereign wealth funds, some of which we have here in Singapore. And then to a lesser extent, the pension funds. I've seen that as a rising trend. There are a few domestic Asian funds of funds, but we obviously do not know where their ultimate source of funds are, but the belief in the industry is that substantially those don't raise their money domestically. They get their money externally. For a long time, Switzerland was the major source of capital for Asian hedge funds. They've always had a reputation for being more adventurous and for being prepared to take more manager risk than, say, more established organizations. Of late, the US investor is definitely becoming more significant. There is a rising tide of interest in Asian capital markets in the United States generally. They now certainly are aware of where China is and of its importance. And the percentage of US capital that we have has done nothing but rise, you know, pretty much over the last 3 years. But from a very small base. For a while, you know, we were literally more than 70% of our capital came out of Europe. So it's a good thing for us as a business, but I think it's a good thing for Asia generally that we're seeing more balance now between Asia, Europe, and the US. There just seems to be a growing level of comfort with it, you know, investing in managers who are a long way from home, which has been difficult for people for a long time, particularly, you know, if you're used to investing with managers who you can virtually all go and visit by just one walk down Fifth Avenue.
Would you like to comment on the outlook for the Asian region?
In late December 2009, we are very uncomfortable with the level of consensus that exists amongst strategists and economists about the outlook for 2010. Everyone seems to be overweight Asia, and China in particular. And Asia ex-Japan, everyone seems to hate Japan. They dislike the demographics, they dislike the debt, they dislike the outlook. Our experience in this part of the world over the last 20 years suggests to us that when the consensus is so much one way, that is inevitably going to be confounded. So we are much more skeptical about what can be delivered from Asian equity markets next year than most of the bulls. We've had a remarkable, extraordinarily strong recovery from the crisis here in Asia. A lot of markets have doubled from their lows. But right now they look fairly fully priced to us. And you know, if there is any, for any reason, profits don't come through in next year, as most people are expecting, analyst expectations of a 30% profit growth in 2010, we struggle to see how those numbers are going to be exceeded. So although there's every reason to assume that the recovery will continue and Asian markets will continue to consolidate, we don't think that the level of expectation currently baked into markets, particularly China, is going to be easy to fulfill. And as a consequence, we see disappointment as being significantly more likely than positive surprises. That's an environment that suits us. So, like most people, we are reasonably bullish about what we do, which is that we think that volatility generally has gone from being exceedingly high this time last year to being actually pretty low by historical standards. You can now buy options and put options massively cheaper than you could last year. And we have every expectation that somewhere along the line in 2010 there'll be some challenges for investors, and that this smooth glide path of China lifting the whole rest of the world is going to run into some difficulties. There's no doubt that China will grow next year. You know, virtually everyone assumes 8, 9 or 10% growth for China next year, and that's the critical number for us here in Asia now. No one really cares what Japan's going to do. It seems almost impossible for it to actually restore some endogenous growth. But with India certainly growing and China certainly growing, those will be the two engines. So the numbers are probably not in any doubt, but the consequences of that and how it'll actually pan out, I think, is going to be full of surprises. Commodity prices remain very elevated for the metals. That has a significant impact on costs in the region. We're starting to see some food price inflation come back. Given how much liquidity is in the system right now, we would expect some of those inflationary pressures to grow. That'll put pressure on margins. In 2007, we also saw some social distress as a consequence of very high food prices. That shouldn't be ruled out as well. Once again, from having been rather more bullish than most people 16 months ago, we're rather more bearish than most people again.